taken from the brilliant Kick Ass 2 soundtrack. There you go, when the Saints go marching in.
Clear the lobby!
It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show. It's the Andy Snowden Radio Show.
What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening.
I'm going downtown tonight. What's going on?
Now, following three sell-out West End seasons, yes, Prime Minister, is fast becoming the most successful play for a decade. Based on the cult TV series, it is now coming up to Theatre Clwyd from the 5th of November for 1 week only. And this time it's starring former EastEnders actor Paul Bradley. Paul Bradley, who rose to fame in the early 80s playing Nigel in the hit soap, and latterly playing the part of Elliot Hope for 10 years in the BBC drama Holby City. But prior to any of this, while at university in Manchester, Paul met Rik Mayall and Ade Edmonson and very quickly became friends, leading to him getting roles in The Young Ones and Bottom and the comic strip Brilliant. Now, on the 5th of November, as I say, Paul comes to Theatre Clwyd in the hit stage show Yes, Prime Minister. And I caught up with Paul in rehearsals earlier this week to discuss all things EastEnders, as you'd imagine, Holby, and of course The Young Ones, and the brilliant Paul. Paul's revelations of the antics of the teenage Rik Mayall and Ade Edmonson whilst at university. This is a brilliant interview, girls and boys. You don't want to miss it, so sit back and enjoy. Paul Bradley on the Stage and Screen Show on Calon FM.
So you're coming up to Theatre Clwyd. Have you played Clwyd before?
No, I haven't, but its reputation is preceding it. It's one of these theatres in the country that's always been sort of an important place to play, and I'm looking forward to going there, really.
Because you started your career, didn't you, in Manchester Royal Exchange?
I did, yes. So... I was at the university there.
And, right.
I was in the crew for a show, and I was understudying. I started understudying people in the show that was on, and somebody fell ill, and I took over from them. And actually, I hadn't learnt his part, but I went away for an hour, learnt it, and then did it that afternoon, and then did it for another 3 weeks.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's a great audition, isn't it?
Yeah, it's great.
If you can do that, you can do anything. So, was it a rep company, was it, that you worked for?
It was. Yeah, right. And I was in another show there afterwards, and then I did a lot of work up in Manchester. I was at the Contact Theatre for a long time.
Yeah.
And did loads of... I mean, it was great in those days, because you got to do a real range of parts, you know, and you were employed for a year, so it was fantastic, you know.
Yeah.
You came back for the following year.
Well, I was going to say, because rep theatre seems to not be around as much as it used to be for some reason. I don't know why.
No, I don't know, because, of course, financially, it's a good idea, because you've got the same actors usually living locally, you know. So I don't know why people don't do it anymore.
Yeah, it's a funny old thing, because as you say, I mean, it works for theatre companies. I mean, it works. It's everything works in their favour. So I don't know why. Yeah. And a great learning curve as well for actors, I suppose.
That's right, and you make really good cum. I actually met Stephen Warbeck, who I've been in a band with for 30 years now, called The Kippers.
Right.
And we started, he was an actor, he started at Contact Theatre with me, and we were mates, and he went on to get an Oscar for writing the music for Shakespeare in Love.
Wow.
So, yeah, we've been in this band for, and we played Ronnie Scott's last, at this time last year.
Well, I was going to ask you about the Kippers band, because when I was doing a bit of research on you, and I saw this, and I thought, is that a real thing? And then I found bits on YouTube, and it's a terrific band. It's tell us about it. What genre of music is it?
Well, we call it stupid world music, because it's sort of world music, and it's silly. I mean, like in one of the songs, one of the tunes I play, Sellotape.
Yeah.
And the lyrics and things are written by Stephen Warbeck. It's sort of a bit mad, really, but we've got the drummer from The Pogue, moves as well, and we're good mates as well, which is great. So, yeah. So doing a gig is really nice because we all get on with each other.
As I walk down the road to the pier, there's a gull with a beak like a spear. At the end of the road, there's a gate, and the rain starts, I might be too late. Father Christmas, old and grey, thin as two twigs in the hay. Where's your red hat? Where's your coat? Why's your reindeer in a boat? As the waves roll and crash down below, and the west...
Well, the Sellotape song is possibly one of the most bizarre things I've seen in a long time. Where, how do you realise you can do that? That's incredible.
Well, it was really funny because I was doing I wasn't playing on that tune, and we were doing a gig, and the band were playing it, and I was sellotaping a set list up, and then I had the sellotape, and I just sort of kept going, and then put it over to the microphone, so it stuck really.
Yeah.
I wrap it around my head, and now I wear safety equipment. I wear goggles and a swimming cap, but
right.
I used to do it without that. And when I was in EastEnders, I sometimes used to get it stuck in my hair, and the next day I'd get told off my makeup, and they'd have to cut it out, you know.
It is. It's terrific. If no one's ever seen that, they got a. There is footage of it on. Well, you did it on this morning as well. I seem to remember.
Yes, that's right. And we did it for. We did Top of the Pops. We did a Children in Need appearance on Top of the Pops.
Yeah.
And apparently, the chap in the sound, because he doesn't have to look at the band. The sound man was going crazy because he couldn't work out where this weird sound was coming from. And then somebody just said, look at what he's doing. Yeah.
It's called The Kippers Band with a silent H. It starts with a H. So what's the story behind that?
Well, because the music sort of sounds Eastern European-y,
yeah.
we were just called The Kippers, but then there's another band called the Kipper Family, and so we thought we'd sort of make a difference, put a small H in front of the big K.
Yeah.
It makes people stop.
Yeah, well, that's it, isn't it? People ask the question, don't they? Because they think, what's that? Yeah. And, well, you've mentioned it there already, but we know you're possibly, back in the 80s, we knew you best for EastEnders, and that's another thing that for any actor, it's a terrific job to get, isn't it? If it's not for the longevity of employment, but the, for everything, really. I mean, it's great pay, it's great everything.
The exposure is something that is sort of quite tricky to get used to. You become instantly famous, and then you have to deal with that. And I was a bit older when it happened to me, so I was a bit more experienced. But I find some people who are sort of quite young, and then they go outside the studio, and they get mobbed, and people say you're great, and it can't but go to your head. I think everyone goes through it, you know. And,
yeah.
And you have to sort of sober up and go, hey, hang on, this is real, you know.
Yeah.
Perhaps my views or aren't as important as people seem to want to tell me they are, you know.
Yeah.
But it does. I think it closes as many doors as it opens, you know, because it certain work stops because they go, oh, right, well, you're so well known now that it's a bit odd. And I think that's why a lot of people who've done telly go back to theatre, because it's tricky to be seen in a different way.
That's right, yeah. I know people always seem to think, yeah, well, you kind of get a little bit typecast if you've been in a soap for too long.
I was in EastEnders for 5 years, and it sorted me. I had a young family at the time, and we were about to be chucked out of a flat, so, you know, it saved us.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed it, you know, and it's the same with Holby, you know. I mean, I was at Holby for 10 years.
Right.
But it's funny, it's both of them are very hard work, but you never get bored.
No.
There's always something new, there's a new storyline, there's new things to do, it's very challenging. So, I think that's why I stayed 10 years, because I wasn't bored, and I really enjoyed it. And it was nice playing had a bit of intelligence, you know.
Well, yeah, because it became...
Nigel wasn't great.
To say the least.
Nice but dim.
Yeah.
Sort of funny, really, because comedy is sort of where I've come from, you know.
I got a little bit excited, I'll be honest with you, when I saw that you'd been in the Young Ones and
yeah.
Bottom.
Well,
and
I was at university with Rik and Ade.
Oh, right.
Knew them really well. I'm still, you know, obviously still in touch with Ade. And,
yeah.
And Rik and I, we were in the same, in Manchester, we were in the same campus, you know. And I remember I was on the 19th floor and he was down below in another building. And we used to have this signal system with our lights where we were going, shall we go for a pint? The answer was invariably yes. And when they, I actually went up for the part of, in the Young Ones, I went up for Mike.
Oh, right.
And which Ben Elton had actually written for himself. And I went auditioned for it, didn't get it. But what was quite nice was that everyone who auditioned there got offered another part. And I was offered a pilot or a co-pilot in the pilot of the
yeah.
first episode.
Right.
And then I did a hippie later on. I was Warlock.
Yeah.
And then I was in Bottom as well. And actually, it was funny because Rik came to see the band, the Kippers, and saw the Sellotape song, and then wrote this character for me in Bottom, where I break into the flat and I get Sellotape to the ceiling.
Fantastic.
He sort of nicked it off the band, you know.
Brilliant. Because you did the comic strip as well, right?
I was in one. Ade directed it. I was in one episode of the comic strip as well, yeah.
Which one was it?
I can't remember. It's so long. It was a very small part. I wasn't very good. But it was nice to get the work, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Pete, I've heard somebody say when they were in the Young Ones, I mean, now in hindsight, that everybody that was in the Young Ones, whether they had a huge part or a cameo, they must be so pleased that they did it because it's part of TV history now. But at the time, there must have been an element of, what is this? Because there was nothing quite like it at the time.
No, that's right. It was very much of the time, you know, sort of quite punky and aggressive. And, I mean, Rik was always really, really funny at university. And I remember one time he did a studio show with Ade, and they were either side of the stage, and they were in these big pink sheets. They got sewn into these big pink sheets, and they just sort of like doing gags, you know, and it was really funny. And afterwards, you have to discuss it with the lecturer, you know. And the lecturer said, it was very funny, but what were you supposed to be? And Rik said, oh, didn't you get it? We were God's f***s. I mean, it was great. And, I miss Rik, much because we were quite close, you know.
Yeah.
And good mates. We went a separate way, as you do. You know, you lose touch. You have your own families, and if you had a party, I'd always be there, and really, really famous people there.
Yeah.
As I say, with Ade. I've played music with him, and we keep up with each other.
Because I went to see Ben Elton, actually. He's on tour, isn't he?
Oh, right.
And, I saw him locally a few weeks ago. And he starts his show off, actually, with a nod to Rik Mayall. It's quite touching, really. It's quite... it's quite scathing, but it's obviously, it comes from the right place. It's quite funny.
It's only much later that you realise that you're with people who are really talented. At the time, you sort of like, oh, well... Everywhere must be like this. And certainly what happened with Rik and Ade was that they broke that sort of Oxbridge comedy stranglehold on BBC comedy, you know, and it suddenly was sort of like punky and Red Rik, and you didn't have to go to Oxford to get a job in British comedy, in BBC comedy, and it was quite refreshing, you know?
Yeah. I mean, as I say, there was nothing quite like it at the time, which kind of leads us brilliantly, thanks for that, Paul, onto what you're doing at the minute. Now, Yes, Prime Minister was obviously a BBC sitcom hit, and on radio as well, so it's almost quite right that it's become a stage play.
Yes, it was done a few years ago, I think, with... David Haig in the part that I'm doing, Jim Hacker. And of course, it was, you know, really big on television. I never really used to watch it all that much on television, although, you know, when I watched it, I really enjoyed it. I think because I was working in theatre, I wasn't around a lot to watch telly in the evening.
Yeah.
But it's an incredibly funny script, you know, I mean, they're fantastic writers. You know, it's a classic and very, very, you know, pertinent to our times. You know, it's about who runs government. Is it the civil service or the politician? You don't have to be a sort of political, you know, you don't have to know a lot about politics. It's fairly simple what's going on. Somebody browbeating somebody else who's supposed to be in control and have the power, being undermined by somebody else for their own devious ends.
But is it sort of set in a specific time, or can it be updated?
No, it's not really. Not in a specific time. And also the politics are unclear. Although Jim Hack is pretty right-wing.
Yeah.
But he could be right-wing Labour, you know, or right-wing. So it's not party political, and it's not... It's set in a sort of Neverland, or a sort of like a... It's non-specific about its time. It doesn't reference any, apart from Europe and the ECB, it doesn't reference anything that would put it into a time frame. So it's quite, you know, you could do it any time. You could do it. It's funny, I read a thing about Jonathan Glynn talking about when they first started writing Yes, Prime Minister. He got newspapers from the 50s. And 30s, and he looked through them, and basically he said the same political problems were there, you know.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, isn't it? Politics kind of, I mean, its face changes, but it almost stays the same in a weird way.
Yeah.
Have you become sort of, I mean, looking at the news today, I mean, it changes every day, doesn't it, mate? But have you become kind of more sympathetic towards politicians after doing this?
Word, but politicians are, I think they used to be admired quite a while ago, and I think partly probably because of Yes Prime Minister and Yes Minister, people have seen a side to politicians that's a bit more devious and self-centred.
Yeah.
Of course, now you have a president who is completely devious and self-centred and lying, and so the things that this satirises, people now accept as being true rather than satire.
Yeah. Well, I've interviewed quite a few comedians over the last couple of years, and they've all said the same thing. They've all said they've stopped talking about Brexit because it's almost writing itself. You can't write anything funny about something as ludicrous as what's going on at the moment. I mean, it's crazy. Is your play a farce? Is that right?
It's sort of. I would. It's not rushing about dropping trousers farce.
No, right.
It is a vocal farce.
Yeah.
It's sort of, a lot of the speeches are very funny, and it has a farce rhythm to it.
Yeah.
And there are problems that occur that are sort of farcical, but it's not a sort of traditional farce where, you know, it's running around, and thank God.
Yeah. So it's coming up to Theatre Clwyd in a couple of weeks. So is there any? Does it go anywhere else after that, or you're not just doing Clwyd, surely?
What happened was that I think Jonathan Lynn was going to rewrite it. They set up a whole tour, and then that fell through. But Theatre Clwyd was booked, and so they thought, well, let's go ahead and see. There was a big interest in it, you know.
For the rest
of the venues, and so it's sort of it's sort of putting a toe in the water for. And it's only 7 performances, you know, so it's got to be special, really, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'm pretty sure it's... there's no better time, I don't think, to do it. I think it's selling out well, that's for sure.
Great.
Paul, it's been an absolute treat to speak to you this afternoon. Thanks ever so much for that.
Brilliant.
And as I say, you're in Theatre Clwyd for 1 week only, in kicking off on 5th of November. Remember.
On Friday night. And I'm back on Holby that night as well.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
All right, marvellous.
Good evening.
Oh, fantastic. Well, thanks ever so much for that. I really appreciate it, honestly. Brilliant.
Great. Thanks very much.
Cheers, buddy.
Cheers.
Take care.
So there you go. That is Paul Bradley, who is coming up to Theatre Clwyd from the 5th of November, the 5th to the 9th. Still tickets available, but low availability, I've been told. So if you want to go and see this show, and it is very popular, you better get yourself up to Theatre Clwyd, or you can phone the box office. 01352 344 101. That's 01352 344 101. That's the box office number. Or you can just go to the webpage, of course. That's theatreclwyd.com. Go on, support your local theatres, ladies and gentlemen. They will not be there forever if you don't. 105 FM.